today we are incredibly fortunate to have Ashley Tellis here with us. And for those of you who have been attending our seminars over the years, he has been kind of our rock star presenter and a great friend of the laboratory. We know him as a scholar, as a diplomat, big thinker, and a policymaker. So we've seen him in many of these incarnations. He comes to us in his role as a scholar at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace and to talk to us about the rise of China and how we should be able to manage the rise of China in a smart way. And that clearly something we're struggling with. Ashley has served in the State Department. He's served at the National Security Council and knows the ins and outs of Washington all too well. So, Ashley, thank you. Ashley, tell us.
Thank you.
I've never used one of these devices before, so this is going to be a bit of an experiment, and hopefully it won't intrude into the presentation. So let's see whether technology lives up to its promise. Well, let me start by actually thanking Bruce and especially Zach for that overly generous introduction. I promise you it is going to cost me a lot in terms of the fine dinner that I'll have to buy him at some point for such generous praise. I want to thank all of you too for, you know, spending time this morning to come and listen to me drone on the subject of China. I suspect today is a slow day at Livermore, which is what accounts for the size of this audience. But I'm delighted to be here and with you again. I always enjoy coming back to the lab, not only because I have good friends here, but because every time I come to the lab, I end up going back to Washington actually smarter. I mean, Washington is a great place to deprive yourself of human capital. I mean, whatever. Whatever you have built up over the years somehow disappears literally in microseconds when you're in the city. So the more often you can escape the city, it's actually an effort in building up your capacity, you know, to cope with the ravages of what the capital does to you. But in any event, I'm going to speak to you about what I think the United States ought to do in terms of dealing with the challenges posed by rising China. Now, when I say that, most people gravitate immediately to the challenges of the day. And there are, of course, plenty of those. Even as we speak, the Chinese are collecting, you know, tons of sand and piling them in these otherwise barren rocks, or around these otherwise barren rocks in the South China Sea. And one of the challenges that DOD and state sort of worry about, you know, today, yesterday, tomorrow, is how do you deal with this sort of creeping effort made by China to create new facts on the ground, to in a sense change very subtly the territorial status quo and confront the region with in a sense new realities that are favorable to themselves. And if you come to Washington and say the word China this morning, most people will be thinking about the South China Sea. Important though that is, I don't want to spend my time today talking about those issues. I want to talk about something that is a little longer range and in some ways far more important, which is China's continuing rise and the challenges that rise poses to the United States. And I want to try and identify why dealing with this phenomenon is actually going to be very difficult, because the environment within which this management of China's rise has to take place, this environment has grown extremely complex. And the kinds of tools that we have at our disposal to deal with this phenomenon are not the kinds of tools that we had during the last great episode of dealing with a major competitor, the Soviet Union. And I'm going to try and identify the differences between the two and show you why this is so much more challenging. Now, of course, all this hinges on a huge unspoken assumption in these conversations. And that assumption is that China will actually continue to rise, right? I have to admit that it is not a given that China will simply rise inexorably, because anyone who knows a little about China knows that this is a country that has tremendous internal challenges, and it has a very peculiar kind of political problem, which is it's trying to sustain an experiment where an open market system is married to a closed and command polity. And we've never really seen in our history any major power actually pull off this experiment successfully in the past. Because what usually happens when you have open market systems is that people get rich. It's one of the things that markets actually do quite efficiently. And when people get rich, they begin to demand the exercise of certain rights, including the right to be governed in accordance with their own preferences. Now, that somehow collides uncomfortably with the Communist Party or the Chinese Communist Party's version of who ought to rule, which is themselves, right? So you have this collision between market economics and command politics, and it is not at all clear that China will be able to find the solution to the contradictions between the two. Now, if we end up in a situation where the Chinese, in a sense, do not manage this contradiction successfully, then it is possible that China will never get to the point where it becomes a great power of sufficient capacity to challenge the United States. And if that turns out to be the case, then you can actually forget everything that I'm going to say here today, because the problem will have disappeared. And, you know, many people sometimes hope that that might be the future of the Chinese experiment, so that it saves us the trouble of having to manage, you know, another complex rivalry for another 30 or 40 years. But I'm operating on the assumption that the Chinese experiment will not come to such a sorry ending anytime soon. And I say that for at least two reasons. One, the Chinese state is actually very conscious of the contradiction. So it's not like these are people who don't understand the nature of the predicament they face. They actually understand it very well. And a very important component of Chinese strategy is to consciously develop a set of tools to deal with this contradiction. And that involves a combination of nationalism on one hand and repression on the other. And China has actually done remarkably well on both. If you look at the last few years, there has been a sharp upsurge in nationalism. And it's a nationalism that oftentimes is stimulated from the top, because the great advantage for nationalism in authoritarian societies is that it generates social solidarities and it compels the population to think of challenges on the outside rather than challenges on the top and on the inside. So we've seen that. And of course, we've seen an impressive increase in the coercive capacity of the Chinese state. In fact, people forget that today the budget of the People's Armed Police, which is essentially the instrument of last resort for internal security, the budget of the People's Armed Police is larger than the budget of the People's Liberation Army in all its three fighting arms. So that should at least give you some sort of a clue as to where the Chinese leadership believes their most immediate challenges are. But in a broader sense, I think the story is that this is not a leadership that is sort of blundering along. It's a leadership that is very conscious of the challenge and is attempting, within the means that it has at its disposal, to deal with this challenge. And so I think there is a reasonable chance that they might be able to sort of make it over the threshold of, you know, internal crises and things like that. There's a second reason why I think one has to assume that China will make it. And that is, China still is a country of enormous latent potential. It is so far from the technological possibility frontier, which is defined by the United States. In fact, the United States defines the technology production frontier for the entire global system. China is so far from it that it has a lot more slack in the system that it can productively use to sustain relatively high levels of economic growth. Now, my own view is that the last 30 years will probably not be sustainable. China has been this amazing experiment where it has grown at double-digit rates for over 30 years. I mean, it is, if you look at the history of human development, there has never been a case where a single country, leave alone a continental-sized country like China, has grown as fast for so long. And there are peculiar reasons for it, and I'm going to touch on some of those. But so China's not going to sustain double-digit growth rates. But even if China slows down, the slowing down in the Chinese case is dropping from 11% growth to 7% growth, or from 7% growth to 5% growth. In fact, anything less than 5% growth, the Communist Party of China considers as a national security threat. Because if you grow at less than 5%, then essentially the societal demands from China's population basically become impossible to sustain. And if the societal demands cannot be sustained, then people start getting funny ideas like they should maybe change the government that rules them, right? And so if you are part of the Politburo, you don't want people getting funny ideas like that. And so there is a concerted effort on the part of the Chinese state to maintain at least reasonably high levels of growth. Now, while a 5 or 6% growth rate might be a slowing down by Chinese standards, it's important to keep in mind it would be considered to be phenomenal performance when you compare it with other growth performances of other countries, including our own. When we grow at 3%, you know, we uncork the champagne because we've had a great year. So if you pit the United States growing, say, at 3% against a China that grows even at 5%, and the timelines are long enough, at some point, the curves begin to intersect, right? And so, and one can kind of have, you know, debates about when exactly those curves intersect because, you know, the robustness of these lines, the robustness of the trends are, in a sense, all open for debate. But the bottom line is this, that a China that continues to grow for a long period of time at a reasonably high level of growth, when compared to the much slower growth rates of both its neighbors and the United States, ends up with only one outcome at the end of the secular period. That is, you have the rise of a new great power. And so for the purposes of my analysis, I operate on the assumption that the Chinese experiment will in fact succeed, that even as China slows, it will get to the point where it can sustain itself. And then that puts us in a position where we might have to confront a possibility that we had never quite imagined 30 years ago, which is that sometime in the foreseeable future, and the foreseeable future meaning not the next 3 to 5 years, but probably the next 30 to 50 years, the world could one day see a return to bipolarity. That is, you would have a China with sufficient geopolitical mass to rival that of the United States, at least by some aggregate measures. I think it will be a long time before Chinese per capita income, for example, begins to rival that of the United States. But the one thing we learned from the Soviet experience during the Cold War is that even countries that do not have populations with per capita incomes that are comparable to your own can still give you a very serious run for your money. They can make your life pretty miserable with GNPs, in the case of the Soviet Union, but that's actually less than half our own. So one has to take the Chinese challenge seriously, even if one admits to all the caveats that Chinese per capita income will lag behind the United States for a long time to come and so on and so forth. As long as one assumes that aggregate Chinese GNP will grow, and that it will grow to levels that actually begin to rival that of the United States, then from my vantage point, we have a political problem that we have to seriously begin to think about. And so the point I start out with is that the US, if it is a rational actor and is thinking over the longer term, it has to confront the possibility that American primacy in the global system will one day be challenged. It will certainly be challenged first in Asia, because as China grows, its ability to exert power will be seen most vividly in Asia, because that's its neighborhood, and only over a period of time radiate outwards from Asia to the wider global system. But all the same, we cannot afford to derive comfort from the possibility that Chinese hegemony will only be felt by the Asians and not by the United States. Because one of the funny things about the global system, whether we like it or not, is that Asia today is the center of gravity in the global economic system. Asia will produce close to 50% of global GNP by 2020. And so any country that has the capacity to control the axial centers of power in the global system will be countries of consequence. It's the reason why the United States went to war twice in a century to protect Europe, first from German domination and then later from Soviet domination. Because at that time, Europe was the axial center of power. And we wanted to make certain that whatever else happens, our adversaries do not control such a large quantum of resources that could one day be used against us. And so even though Chinese power will be felt immediately, first in Asia and only later in the wider global system, the United States cannot afford to be indifferent to that prospect. There's also another reason why I think we should be concerned and start thinking seriously about this possibility, is that since the end of the Second World War, the United States has built and maintains essentially an American-dominated international regime. And we created this international regime, everything from managing proliferation to protecting human rights, to creating a Bretton Woods economic system, to creating a system of international liberal institutions. Not entirely because we were altruistic, right? The altruism is a useful point in public diplomacy, and I'm not opposed to occasionally talking about it as if this was a public good service that we rendered the world. We did it first and foremost for our own interest. We did it to protect ourselves, because the idea of creating a world that was favorable to our interests is first and foremost beneficial to the United States. But luckily, it benefited others as well. And so others have a stake, actually, in the viability of the American international system, which has been put in place since the Second World War. And guess what? This system does not survive if American power begins to decay. I mean, that's the funny thing about imperial systems, is that usually as the imperial powers that brought the systems into being begin to weaken, the system either atrophies or it mutates into some other system that serves somebody else's interest. And so if the United States has to be in the business of protecting its own interests, not to mention the interests of our allies and our friends and all the other neutrals who essentially benefit from the American notion of order, then we have to pay particular attention to protecting our own power in the face of the rise of this new competitor, China. Now, I want to start this presentation on the substantive end by making a very important point that often gets lost, which is that unlike previous great powers, at least in the Western experience after 1492, China's rise is actually quite unique. If you look at other major powers, whether it was Venetian Italy, or whether it was the maritime states like Genoa, all the way to the powers that followed, Portugal, Spain, the Dutch Empire, ending up with France and Great Britain, the unique thing about, or the common thing about the rise of all these great powers, was that their rise occurs as a result of domestic transformations within their own society and the creation of a powerful state that then uses the resources that are produced by those societies to go out and then expand their imperial ambitions over the globe. So what do you get in the case of previous great powers, at least in the Western experience, is that these are essentially self-contained entities at the time of their rise. The transformations that are occurring fundamentally within their own societies. And it's usually population growth and technical change. So population growth and technical change begin to create resources in larger quantities than the society experienced before these two variables began to interact. And the evolution of their own state system allowed the state to then mop up these additional resources that their societies were producing. And then the state goes out with these resources to build an empire. So it's essentially an inside-out story. So there is a transformation that's taking place on the inside, and then the effects of that transformation are basically seen on the outside. The Chinese experience is unique because while there is an internal transformation, China's rise does not depend entirely or solely on the internal transformation, but it depends fundamentally on an external environment that the United States creates that actually makes this transformation possible. And to understand this, one has to go back to the post-war period, circa 1945. So think 1945, right? The United States is now a victor in the Second World War. It presides over, it's the new hegemonic power in the international system. It has an opportunity to essentially recreate the global system in its own image and likeness. And it proceeds to do exactly that. And what is the essence of this recreation? The essence of this recreation is that it's going to sustain essentially an open market system beyond its own borders. And, you know, at the height of American ambition in 1945, we actually set out to create an institution called the International Trade Organization. And it was an international, the institution was meant to essentially create a global economic system which would enforce rules of free trade across borders. Now, for various reasons, the ITO basically never came to be because Congress refused to sign the legislation that would make the ITO possible. But what the US did was it went to Plan B. And Plan B was, we're going to create an open market system, not for the whole world, because now we don't have the resources through the ITO to create something like this. So we're going to create an open market system that ties only our allies. Now, again, in that moment of, you know, victory and tinged with a little hubris, in 1945, we invited the Soviets to be part of this market system because being good liberal romantics, right, that we are, we thought trade would be the solution to all our political differences. And that was actually the animating idea behind ITO. The idea behind ITO was to make war obsolete for the final time. Now, you've heard this story before. So we were going to make war obsolete for the final time by essentially creating a global open market system where if people were trading, they had no reason to fight. Because Congress, in its less than perspicacity, killed the ITO, we basically said we're going to do this only with our allies. But because the Soviet Union was a partner in the Second World War, we invited the Soviet Union to join. Now, thankfully for us, the Soviet Union declined, because the Soviets were deeply suspicious of free markets to begin with. Stalin didn't want to have any part in this American plot. And so he sat the Soviet Union out. So the open market system after the Second World War was essentially one that simply tied us and our allies. What we did was we provided the allies with a great deal of economic assistance, the Marshall Plan in Europe, bilateral plans in Japan.
And the idea was that we were now going to trade with one another, and that trade would allow us to grow faster compared to the alternative of not trading. And that became the recipe for us eventually coping with Soviet expansionism. The reason at the end of the day why the Western community is able to compete with the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact is because we end up having the more productive economies compared to the opposition. And that productivity was enhanced fundamentally by the fact that we were technological leaders, a technological leadership that was forged in the fulcrum of war. And that technological leadership was spread over a wider Western system through trade. Now, a funny thing happens as this process sort of continues, right? We begin to recognize that while trade is certainly improving the quality and the capacity of the West writ large to cope with the Soviet Union, our allies are actually gaining in relative terms far more than we are. And that was partly by design, because remember who our allies were. They were the war-torn states. Even a country like Great Britain was really, although it was part of the victors, it was brutally damaged by the experience of World War II. When you look at new allies like Germany, they were absolutely decimated. So the US calculation was, even though our partners are gaining in relative terms relative to ourselves, there's really no problem at the end of the day, because the relative gains are, in a sense, being enjoyed by our allies. And if, as a result of their enjoyment of these relative gains, they become more capable of dealing with Soviet aggression, then our strategic aims are actually advanced. So when you look at the first wave of post-war globalization, it actually has a happy ending for us. Even though the economic outcomes are sort of not perfect, if you are a strict economic nationalist, right? Because you've suddenly got now Germany rising up as a potential competitor, industrial competitor. You have Japan suddenly rising up as an industrial competitor. You console yourself by saying, look, at the end of the day, you know, I don't have to worry about German nuclear weapons or Japanese nuclear weapons, only Soviet ones. So that first wave of post-war economic expansion turned out to be a great thing. What happens is the worm in the apple comes about because of the second wave. And the second wave starts really sometime in the 1970s, and it starts with China. And it starts with China not at the economic level, but at the political level. Because in our effort to compete with the Soviets, we begin to reach out to the Chinese in an effort to create a balancing coalition. And that is really the strategic meaning of Nixon's visit to China and everything that follows, right? So we begin to reach out to the Chinese, and the goal in reaching out to the Chinese, which was not Nixon's original plan, by the way. I mean, Nixon's original plan was straightforward geopolitics. The Soviets are a pain in the neck. They're becoming more and more powerful. They're really giving us a lot of grief in places as far away as Latin America and Africa. We need to find ways of giving them a little trouble closer to home. And the way to repay them and give them a little trouble closer to home was to get China into the camp. And so that was the Nixonian calculation, was straightforward billiard ball balance of power politics. But again, being, you know, good American romantics, after the initial rapprochement with China took place, our ambitions with China began to increase. And we were not thinking of the partnership with China simply involving geopolitics, but rather large-scale integration into the liberal world system. And so successive presidencies, actually starting with Jimmy Carter, and then reaching the high point under Ronald Reagan, the effort was reach out to China and bring them into the global trading system. And I'm going to talk about the assumptions that underlay the shift in policy, but the whole notion was, if we can somehow help China to become strong and powerful, our efforts to defeat the Soviet Union would be even more robust. And there were, of course, three assumptions when we thought particularly about China. The first assumption was that if we help China become part of the liberal system, China will slowly become democratic, right? Because once people actually get injected into free markets, you know, they recognize the virtues of making money, they become richer, and, you know, like good Americans, they begin to demand rights. And so the assumption was, oh, even though these are communists today, one day they will become democratic simply as a process of economic transformation. There was a second assumption that underlay the integration agenda, was that as China became more developed, it would become more cosmopolitan. That is, Chinese, 1 billion of them, 1.2 billion of them, or whatever the numbers are, right, would actually become like the homo economicus of rational economic theory. They wouldn't start thinking about country and nation and state. They'd only be thinking about their pocketbooks. And if all they cared about their pocketbooks, they would naturally become traders and not nationalists. So the assumption was you would create essentially a new cosmopolitan entity and not a nationalist entity. And there was a third assumption, because when the integration agenda really gathered steam under Carter, reaching the high point under Reagan, China, if you remember, was still a very poor society. So it was very easy for us to tell ourselves that actually integrating China would be a good thing for us. It would open up China's markets, it would give our companies an opportunity to make money in China, and so on and so forth, right? But nobody ever assumed that that project might turn out to be so successful that it might one day fundamentally alter the global balance of power. Because if we had thought about that, then either we might not have proceeded with the integration agenda, or if we did proceed with the integration agenda, we would have done so only in a fit of absence of mind. Because you cannot imagine a rational state basically saying, I'm going out there now to create a new competitor to myself because I'm feeling deprived of competitors, right? You can't imagine a state doing that. So there are these three assumptions that underlie our China policy over the last 20 or 30 years. And so we've now reached the point where we reach out to China, we work with China, not only at the political level, but fundamentally at the economic level. And in the process, we aid in China's transformation. And how exactly did we do that? Very simple. We basically told the Chinese that they have free and open access to all global markets that come within the purview of the liberal international economic system maintained by the United States, but most importantly, free and unfettered access to the American market. Now, the great thing about the American market is that we have 330 or 350 million consumers, right? And luckily for us, we all happen to be very rich consumers. So if you are a seller of products to the United States, you usually leave the transaction incredibly happy because you have 350 million Americans parting with real money. Now, when the Chinese begin to undertake their economic reforms after Deng in the 1980s, they make the very conscious decision that their economic reform is not going to be aimed at expanding the internal Chinese market, at least not in the first instance, but it's going to be aimed at becoming the workshop for the world, which means producing goods for other people's markets. And because this integration was so successful, China essentially grows on the back of the access to the international economic system. So the first point to keep in mind is the difference in China's growth trajectory compared to the growth trajectory of previous rising powers. Previous rising powers grew through the expansion of their own domestic markets and the transformation of their own societies internally. China grows through the expansion of an international market. An expansion of the international market because the United States welcomes it into the liberal international economic order. And so while China makes internal transformations of some importance, those transformations would not have borne the kind of fruit if it did not have access to the global system. Okay? So now, two outcomes essentially result from this dynamic. One is that the Chinese economic experiment becomes successful and produces resources that are available to the Chinese state for the pursuit of whatever geopolitical objectives the state may have. And the second is that we now end up in essentially a mutual hostage relationship with China in the realm of economics. Now, the key and important point to keep in mind is that we never had this mutual hostage relationship with the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union did us the great favor of declining to join the ITO, of declining to be part of the Western market system. And because it declined to be part of the Western market system, the Soviet Union and its allies lived in a completely separate universe from our own. And because they lived in a separate universe from our own, when the Soviet Union became a geopolitical threat, we were able to deal with them through a strategy of containment. Now, let me tell you what containment was and why it actually worked. Containment basically had four components. The first element was you isolate the Soviet Union from all the global centers of power. So for us, the fact that the Soviets, in a fit of momentary miscalculation, said no to joining the liberal order was a godsend, because it meant that the Soviet Union could not trade with the most productive and technologically advanced economies in the world. I mean, they could trade with Bulgaria, and they could trade with Hungary, but they could not trade with West Germany, they could not trade with the United States, they could not trade with Japan. So they were cut off from the centers of power. And the United States very consciously, as a matter of national strategy, set out to make certain that the walls that surrounded the Soviet Union with respect to economic isolation grew higher, deeper, and thicker, right? The second was we were able to create a unified alliance system, which was NATO in Europe and then the bilateral security arrangements in the East. And those unified alliance systems worked because all the partners felt uniformly threatened by the Soviet Union. But most importantly, all the partners had absolutely no interdependencies with the Soviet Union. So we ended up in a wonderful situation where all our friends were threatened by the Soviets, and none of them were dependent on the Soviets that they actually had to take Soviet calculations into account. The only calculations they had to take into account was, don't do anything to get the Soviet Union crazy enough to actually launch missiles at you. Right? That was the only calculation. But you didn't have to worry about, oh, you know, are we going to lose if we don't sell the Soviet Union X? Are we going to, gain if we do something in Soviet? Those calculations are completely irrelevant, right? The third was, of course, the strategy of collective defense. We created the alliance system to actually do collective defense tasks, where we actually apportioned tasks to all our partners in terms of, in case of a war, this is what you do, this is what we do, and so on and so forth. And the fourth was a worldwide campaign of ideological delegitimation. We combated the Soviet Union like this was a Manichaean conflict between light and darkness and good and evil, right? We went to the furthest corners of the planet to badmouth the Soviet Union. I mean, we created an institution called the United States Information Agency, whose only job was to conduct American propaganda in the campaign against the Soviet Union during the Cold War. And the elements of the campaign were, this is an illegitimate system, it's a collectivist system, it violates human rights, it's not respectful of individuals, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Whether this was true or false was completely irrelevant. We were involved in an absolute high-stakes conflict with these guys, and we were going to stop at nothing to bring these guys down peacefully. That was the essence of the game. Now, the problem that we have today is that we simply cannot use this strategy with the Chinese. And we cannot use this strategy with the Chinese for the very simple reason that economic interdependence now constrains our options. It is very hard to conduct war against your banker. It's very hard, right? And the problem that we have is that if we are uncomfortable with what China is doing, we cannot attempt to punish China without in the process punishing ourselves. We never had that problem with the Soviets. And therefore, even though containment was a challenging policy at the practical level, right? I mean, if those of you who lived through the containment days will know, we had debates about our defense policy. We had debates about our alliance policy. You know, it was not easy in practical terms. But conceptually, it was easy. We knew what had to be done. With China, there is no equilibrium solution of how you compete under conditions of interdependence. And so the problem that we have with the Chinese is that even if Chinese power grows, which it is likely to, and which it is likely to grow as a result of continuing trade with the United States, we still don't have that magic solution called containment, which we can deploy with China. Now, this is the irony of the whole wretched situation that we find ourselves in. Interdependence makes both of us richer, right? But it happens to make some countries richer than others. I mean, the things that they don't tell you in Neoclassical Economics 101 is this, that trade is a wonderful thing. But in a world of pure economics, the differences in the relative gains from trade don't have any geopolitical consequences. Because in the world of pure economics, all you have are individual utility-maximizing agents. Individual utility-maximizing agents who are not about to kill the partner that they're trading with. That would mess up the model big time, right? So in the world of pure economics, it's simply my utility function, your utility function. How do we trade to make certain that the sum total of our welfare gains is greater than if we were autarkic? But you so that's what drives our economic policy. So if you look at American economic policy, it's let's expand free trade to the world, right? Because the logic of economics is there is no security threat. I don't really have to worry about the fact that that guy is growing twice as fast as I am. Because if at the end of the day, both of us are doing better than a world of not trading, it's good for us. In the world of politics, this becomes lethal. Because if the other guy is growing twice as fast as me, and therefore has resources which he can then apply to building a bigger spear, the day can come when he doesn't have to trade with me. All he has to do is kill me. If he thinks his geopolitical interests are served by recourse to that kind of a strategy. So we end up now in this world where we are literally interlocked with the Chinese, where their growth continues to depend on trade with us, where our prosperity continues to depend on trade with them, and therefore dealing with their growing power becomes a challenge that simply cannot be resolved through containment. So what I have argued is that you need a strategy that's going to be much more subtle than we have ever had to pursue in the past. And at the end of the day, we are Americans, right? We don't do subtle well. Anything that involves excessive subtlety is a tad beyond our reach. Because in any democracy, what you want are simple strategies that you can sell your public and which don't require too much complexity. So the odds against us being able to pull off a strategy like this are actually high. But it's the only strategy that actually meets the demand of the predicament. And so I want to lay out what I think are the key components of the strategy. The first is we have to sustain comprehensive engagement with China in economic terms, as well as political terms. I mean, we're not looking for a fight, is the bottom line. And to the degree that we can create a set of economic relations that allow us to grow because of trade, allow them to grow because of trade, we simply have to persist with that world because it is in our interest, okay? There's one asterisk, though, to this strategy. Even as we implement it, we have to be very careful to make certain that the world of free trade does not expand or does not extend to technologies that give the Chinese a military advantage. So even as you are continuing comprehensive engagement, you have to seriously think of recreating something like a COCOM regime. And the bad news here is that it can't be a COCOM regime manned entirely by the United States, because today there are other countries that have the technologies that in yesteryears we alone had. So it means actually roping your partners, the Europeans, the Japanese, and any neutral, into creating a new regime that will at least keep some key technologies out of China's grasp, even as you continue to expand economically. The second is, you need a strategy that allows you to, in a sense, make China's life a little more difficult than it is. And that requires you to build up the national capacities of countries that exist on China's periphery. Because what do you need are essentially multiple lines of defense. You don't want to be in a situation where you have to cope with the Chinese alone. And the best way for doing that is to basically make a very conscious aspect of your foreign policy or your national security policy to basically raise the capacity of key countries on China's periphery. And there are three or four countries that are critical here. Japan is one, India is another, Vietnam is a third, Indonesia is a fourth. Because if you have countries that are powerful enough, it limits China's freedom of action and thereby reduces the burdens that the United States has to deal with on its own. The third is you have to modify your approach to maintaining an open international trading regime by grafting on the current system, the current WTO system, what I call preferential free trading agreements, right? These are partial free trading agreements. And the two great ones that we are pursuing are the TPP in East Asia and the TTIP in Europe. Now, people think of these two agreements purely in economic terms, and I think that's a mistake. You want to think of these agreements fundamentally in strategic terms. And what is the logic? The logic is simple. If you can create extremely high-quality trade agreements with your friends, because that's what TTIP and TPP is, it allows you a chance to buy back some of the relative gains losses that you are experiencing through the WTO system. So essentially what you're doing is, you're basically saying, as long as we are confined to the world of the WTO, we are always going to get less from it than China will. And so what we're going to do is we're going to create two subsets of countries that essentially have comparable income levels to our own, that are willing to trade far more intensively than the WTO system permits us to trade. And that allows us to gain higher relative gains compared to simply trade in the WTO. So for example, TTIP would add close to 1 percentage point to our GDP every year, which is huge. TPP is less. It's about 0.4 to 0.5 of GDP, but still significant. So you graft these free trade agreements, limited free trade agreements, onto the global system. The next is, make certain that your capacity to project power in Asia never gets blunted. Because if you lose the capacity to project power in Asia, right up to China's coast, in effect what you've lost is you've lost your Asian alliances. Because if the Japanese, if the Koreans, and anybody else cannot count on the United States being able to come to their rescue in case of a crisis, you've lost Asia. And then you go back to the first point I made. If you lose Asia, you lose the world, right? So power projection has to be a critical task. And then last, and perhaps the most difficult, is you have to revitalize the US economy at home. Because at the end of the day, everything that I've suggested is important, but it does not deliver by itself. The only thing that delivers by itself is the US economy and its ability to engage in relentless, disruptive innovation. So we've got to create an economic system at home that allows us to make certain that the US economy is a high-velocity, innovating society. And you know, all you have to do is read the first chapters of Joseph Aloysius Schumpeter to know that all races in international politics are actually races in international economics. And all races in international economics are simply races about who can innovate faster than the other guy. If I can innovate faster than you, I get the supernormal profits that come from innovations until competitors and emulators catch up. And by the time they catch up, I'm on to the next innovation, right? So that's the game. But to do this, we have to do three things very, very smartly. The first is we have to figure out how to deal with the challenges of labor force growth in the United States, which means it takes you immediately to our education policy, it takes you immediately to our immigration policy. Growth requires two things. It needs capital and it needs labor. And we need to have a smart immigration policy, because the great thing the United States does, and better than anybody else in the world, is steal other people's talent, right? It's what keeps us in business. And it's the one thing that actually permits us to maintain sustained open-ended growth. I mean, people don't realize this, that the asset that we have because of our ethos, our immigrant ethos, is that we can open and close the tap anytime. So if there is a labor force crisis, you open the tap and you get people in. If you have a saturation in the labor force, you close the tap and you cut immigration for a while. So we need a rational immigration policy. Second, we need to be able to maintain our capacity for technical change, which means STEM. We've got to do much better in STEM. We've got to start investing in education. There is no way we can maintain the kind of technological superiority for any of the things that I identified if at the end of the day we are not creating a cadre of people who basically are technically proficient. I mean, I love poetry, but we may be having too many poet laureates, right? I want people who do nifty things that are done in places like this, because this is the stuff that translates both economically and in power politics. The third thing we have to do is repair our public finances. Repair our public finances. No nation can remain a great power perpetually in debt to others. I mean, you can do it for a while, but you cannot remain a great power simply relying on others to subsidize your consumption. And so we have to think seriously about what we need to do to get our public policy with respect to balancing our budgets, increasing our savings rates, and so on and so forth. For the moment, we still have the advantage because, as the Chinese know, they've accumulated so many trillions of US dollars, they don't know what to do with them. So they have to sterilize these dollars, and they're having enormous trouble sterilizing these dollars because they are in a catch-22 themselves. If they stimulate domestic consumption, they stop earning the kinds of foreign exchange reserves that they've earned so far. If they continue to earn the foreign exchange reserves as they've earned for the last 30 years, what do they do with them? They can't keep them in a bank in China. They don't earn very much, so you have to find a way to sterilize them. But we have to help the process out by finding a way to change the balance so that we save a little more than we do, and so on and so forth. Now, the bottom line is this. The strategy to cope with China is going to be a very complicated strategy of the kind that I've outlined, and it's going to be a very subtle strategy. And it's a strategy that is going to require a conscious government that thinks about it in strategic terms. If you have visited Washington lately, you will spend quite a bit of time searching for such a government. It doesn't exist. And if you look at the ramp up to the elections in 2016, there is no promise that such a government is going to exist. So we end up essentially with strategic choices or, you know, alternative paths, which either result in, at some point, a Chinese eclipse of the United States. That's one possibility. Or you end up in a second path, which is something happens and the American polity suddenly wakes up. We've had moments like that. They were called Pearl Harbor, they were called 9/11, right? And suddenly one fine morning, people who were happy going about their daily business suddenly wake up. Or there is a third path, which is you anticipate the challenges that are coming down the line, and you slowly begin to reorient your public policy to deal with these challenges. Because that is the smart thing to do, and at the end of the day, compared to the three alternatives, it's also the cheapest thing to do. I'm going to end on that note. Thank you very much. Do we have time for some questions?
We have time for questions?
Yeah, sure.
All right. We have a little bit of time for questions. One thing is always certain. Actually, we'll leave you smarter than you were. John.
Yeah, I'll have to apologize. The parochialism of this question after such a grand talk. But we're here at Lawrence Livermore. If you look at the room behind me, we're all pretty much techies. Sorry. So what do techies do? I read your report, by the way. You had to be a polymath to read the report, so good.
Thank you.
But here, as techies, what can we do? And the obvious thing, this will be delusional, just bear with me, is one of the few things we can do is with your idea of we need to bolster the nations around the periphery of China. By the way, you never mentioned Pakistan. You mentioned the whole set except Pakistan. We'll overlook that. Okay.
I have a reason for that. But
is it delusional for people like us to look at the idea of some international, a pact, a nuclear security and stability pact? We help them with PALs that are transparent and opaque the way they need to be, physical security aids, all opaque, so we don't...
Right.
This is partly from talking with Zach. But
sure.
Some way to get a... it's almost sort of soft power.
Mm-hmm.
And it gets a little bit of a toehold on the periphery of China.
Mm-hmm.
I remember I used to share an office with an East German, and he would show me this picture, the Soviet Union all ringed by it. Well, we can do a little bit of that with China, on maybe three of the four sides of China. So is this something, this may be delusional, it may be politically impossible. So let me run, what can techies do to help?
Well, actually techies have to do a lot. Have to do a lot. Because let me answer it in two parts. One was the specific Pakistan question, which I'll just leave aside for the moment. I'll come back to it. But the broader question is this. See, what finally makes the United States competitive in terms of the international economy and powerful in terms of the global system is not what guys like I do. Like, I'm a poet, right? I mean, I'm a political scientist by training, which, for those of you who don't know the discipline, is completely oxymoronic. I mean, the idea that you can have political science, right? But so we are poets. Like, if Plato had seen me, he would have said, you're a poet. I am good for preaching. So I'm happy to go to the Congress and preach about the need for sound public policy. But what makes the United States strong is what you guys do. It's really true. So and I'm not saying this to flatter you. I would say this even if I was talking to other poets.
Okay.
So the challenge. But that's the asterisk, right? But the challenge is this. We have to look for where we can breach the frontiers in terms of technological innovation. So for example, if tomorrow you could show me that that fancy ignition facility that you have is actually delivering on the promise, you've suddenly transformed the nature of the global energy system. And you know what? I have it, they don't. It's that simple. I mean, everyone knows the physics of it, right? I mean, even my 10-year-old, high school class knows the physics. But to get the engineering right, to actually make this productive, that's our advantage. And so this raises now several derivative questions. Is the nation focused enough on the need to encourage what Schumpeter would call the leading sectors of the economy? I mean, I love free markets, but the history of the West is very clear that if you do not have perspicacious states that are willing to, as a matter of public policy, lead by investing in certain core capabilities, the free market will not deliver. I mean, we saw this in the Second World War, we saw this in the post-Cold War period. The Department of Defense was singularly responsible for a whole slew of innovations that have come to define the character of our life today. Think GPS, the Iridium satellite system. All the things that we did. I mean, Glad wrap, or what is the Saran wrap?
Yeah.
right? The stuff that we invented to prevent, you know, dirt from getting into rifles. I mean, so you have to get the appropriate mix between keeping an economic system that is open enough so that ideas have a place to function and sort of fructify, but it must be aided by a state that is very supportive, particularly of cutting-edge endeavors where the potential for return is possibly small. So you need to be able to do that sort of stuff. So that would be my short answer, which is that, to my mind, long-term American supremacy is fundamentally a function of technological advantage. And so the kinds of things that are done in places like this, and it doesn't have to be just in the world of weapons, right? I mean, it has to be in the worlds of energy. It has to be in the worlds of materials. It has to be in the worlds of transportation. It has to be in the worlds of biology. You know, I mean, when you're looking at things like recombinant DNA, when you're thinking of GMO, I mean, this is all expanding the biological universe, right? I mean, this is what ultimately translates into products and services, which give you the advantage. So the question really that you have to ask is, how do I preserve economic advantage? I preserve economic advantage by basically putting products in the marketplace that give me supernormal rates of return. And I get that only through innovation, which means how do I nurture a culture of innovation? And it always has to be some combination of state support plus a more open, more flexible economic system. We'll deal with Pakistan differently because...
Questions?
Yeah. One of the countries I put on the border that you also left out was Russia. And you know, you have a country there with that has joined at some level the economic system, is no longer completely isolated, is very rich in resources, which China very much is looking at.
Yes.
And so there's a re-engagement between them, and that's something that is going to be significant, I would think.
Absolutely. And nothing causes me greater grief than to see Russia in bed with the Chinese. Because by rights, right, Russia and China have such a history of geopolitical competition among themselves that if nature were to take its course, Russia would be a Western power. Because the Russians are so fearful of the Chinese, they're fearful of the Chinese more than they are of any other nation on earth. And yet, the tragedy is, because of our inability to manage politics on the European continent as successfully as we should have, we've ended up in a situation where the Russians are gravitating towards their own worst enemies. And to my mind, a success in terms of balancing China in the way that I described is going to become much harder if we do not have a strategy to peel away the Russians from the Chinese. It is absolutely important over the long term. Because Russia can balance China on its own if it puts its mind to it. It's got the territory, it's got the space, it's got the frontier. It even has the technology, right? So how do we go about doing that? I guess the first step would be to pop off Putin. In the old days, we actually had institutions that, you know, knew how to do these things, right? Now we can't do this stuff. But the problem is that Putin certainly has taken Russia in a direction which I think is deeply unfortunate for Russia itself, not to mention the larger international community. And I have no optimism that we will be able to peel the Russians as long as Putin is in charge, which means that this is a post-Putin project.
Does the fact that both China and Russia are using the nationalistic that might give you some hope for the future.
Well, what it gives me hope is that I'm confident that there will never be a permanent alliance between these two countries because there are enough objective contradictions. But the problem is, you know, as John Maynard Keynes once said, when people criticized that his theory did not pay sufficient attention to the long run, you know, he said in the long run, they're all dead. Right? That's the problem. In the long run, the Russians and the Chinese have enough antagonisms that they will likely pull apart. But until we get to that point, there is a lot of damage they can do to our interests. And so we do need a near-term strategy for thinking about how to engage with Russia. But I just fear that we cannot get to that point as long as Putin is around.
So I want to take on the topic of the Chinese population. They seem to have harnessed this 1.2 billion people very well, surprisingly well. So their population is aging.
The one-child policy has been disastrous, right? First, if you look at gender imbalances in China, for example, they are unbelievable. I mean, you are going to have a real gap which affects the demographic prospects for the society. China's challenge is that it is going to grow old before it grows rich. But remember, demography is not destiny. I mean, demography shapes your destiny. But, you know, societies are creative enough that you can actually deal with these challenges. So, for example, as human longevity increases, it is possible to think of people working longer in their lifespan and thereby compensating, at least in part, for what would be constrictions in the labor force, right? So, as China grows in terms of its health, people will live longer, and people will have productive lives longer. So they don't have to retire at 55, they don't have to retire at 60. So that's one solution. The second solution, of course, is immigration, right? I mean, you could conceive of an immigration strategy that helps you overcome at least some of these deficits. Now, there are cultural issues here. You know, China is generally a relatively homogenized society, blah, blah, blah. Would they be comfortable actually opening up to immigration? But maybe from the other cynic populations in the periphery, that's a possibility. But that's the second possibility. The third possibility is simply technology. You can always do capital labor substitutions. So machinery doing some of the things that previously required labor. So if you're conscious of the problem, there are ways in which you can seek to mitigate the challenges of a compressing labor force. And the Chinese are very conscious of this. And the first sign that they're serious about dealing with this was the fact that they've now relaxed the one-child policy. It's not, unfortunately, they haven't gone as far as I think a rational leadership would have gone, which is to simply say, you know, forget about the one-child policy. We don't care. Go out and have as many children as you want. But there are things that you can do. I mean, Nazi Germany was actually an amazing example of how Germany between the 20s and the 40s actually changed its birth rates dramatically simply through state incentives for increasing, you know, for increasing the number of children. Now, you can, so it's not as if, you know, countries are sort of mute spectators to demographic transitions. They can affect those outcomes. But the problem that you point out to is a very real one, and certainly one that they understand completely and are very, very cognizant of.
A couple more?
Sure.
You okay?
Sure.
Yeah, you had another over here?
Yeah. You mentioned that there's the prospect that their control politics and their open markets will fail. Is that in the sense that their control politics will change? What do you estimate the likelihood of that happening as they become richer, becoming more democratic? You seem panicked about going the other way, but not panicked.
You know, it's a very difficult question to answer because the problem with authoritarian regimes is that they are successful until they fail, right? So when you look at their capacity to deal with the challenge, they deal with the challenge and all the instruments you can imagine. They'll increase repression, they'll increase surveillance, they'll increase co-optation, and so on and so forth. But suddenly something happens, like a Tiananmen, right? And the systems are brittle enough that they cannot cope with it. So it's really hard to imagine what China's future will be like. Now, if I was a Chinese leader, my strategy would be progressive relaxation of personal freedoms, but be very careful about extending that to political freedoms. So what I would essentially do is I would say, look, the state is not going to intrude in your lives, so you can go out and do exactly what you want in your personal life, but don't get too uppity and demand things like, you know, the right to elect your leader and so on and so forth. So that's the trade you made. Now, that's in effect what was happening until Xi became president. The deal that Hu Jintao and others tried to make was, we'll give you two things that should keep you satisfied. One is we guarantee you high growth rates in perpetuity, right? So you're always going to be richer tomorrow than you were yesterday. And of course, if you don't have us, then the alternative is chaos when you go back to living the life of the peasant. So that is the first element of the social contract, was I'll keep you richer tomorrow than you were yesterday. And the second element of the social contract was, I'm going to increase your personal freedoms, but not your political freedom. And so, for example, you know, after Deng, Chinese didn't have to go around wearing blue Mao suits, right? You could go out and actually buy Fendi and, you know, buy all the finest, you know, apparel from, you know, Western fashion houses and, you know, live as comfortably as you want. But there were very strict limits to the exercise of that freedom. So you couldn't go to Tiananmen Square and, you know, oppose the Communist Party. Or you couldn't call for regime change in China. Or you couldn't call for giving the Tibetans greater autonomy or the Taiwanese freedom. So the trade was, I'll give you personal liberty, but I'm not going to give you political liberty. And for most Chinese, right, you have to understand a little about the culture here. For China, the biggest threat, because it's a 5,000-year-old civilization, is always the fear of chaos. When people ask me, is the Chinese state a repressive state? The answer really is yes and no. Because it's not a state where people are compliant only because the state has a huge people's armed police. That's part of the answer, but it's not the whole answer. It's amazing how Chinese, ordinary Chinese, even when they detest the regime, believe that a detestable regime is preferable to the alternative of chaos. So there is a certain self-compliance simply because they are afraid that if something happened and the regime suddenly disappeared, the alternative would not be democracy, but the alternative would be chaos, which has been the bane of China over the centuries. And it's because the fear of chaos is really what motivates compliance, that the Chinese state has had to use repression only extraordinarily, not ordinarily. So you don't have, in the ordinary case, secret police sitting outside your house. I mean, unless you're a known offender who needs to be sort of, you know, kept track of. But it's not like it's a surveillance state. You can go to China, you can go anywhere you want, you can do a lot of things, as long as it's within the realm of personal autonomy. So the state exploits the very real fear that citizens have of chaos. And unfortunately, in China's modern history, there have been, you know, periods of chaos like the Cultural Revolution, which just frightened the Chinese. My God, the last thing they want is a return to days like the Cultural Revolution, where, you know, your neighbors betrayed you, husbands betrayed their wives, you know, children betrayed their parents. I mean, that would be a disaster. So I honestly can't answer that question in terms of, you know, how long will the system survive? I don't know. It survives until it survives, and then one day something happens, and then these systems crumble.
All right. Well, please join me in, first of all, designating Ashley to be Livermore's Poet Laureate, and secondly, for thanking him for
Thank you.